Hello and a very warm welcome to our today Single Pair Ethernet Pioneer Summit, the digital coffee break with the topic on magnetics. First of all, I will introduce me and my colleague who will make the webinar for you today. So my name is Matthias Fritsche. In my business life, I work for Harting, the Harting Technology Group, and I'm here today as the technical chair of our working group in our Single Pair Ethernet Partner Network. The session will be held today from my network colleague, Martin Leinseder, and very soon I hand over to Martin. Hello, Martin, again. So before we start our session today, some technical issues. So the session will take around 45 minutes. After the session, you have the chance to get answers of your questions. You can use during the webinar our chat function as usual to send us questions. And later on, if you want to see the session again, we have also a recording for you, and also you can invite other colleagues to join it. Some words about our network. So the Single Pair Ethernet Industrial Partner Network is a foundation with now around 50 companies. And the goal of this foundation is to build together everything what is needed to bring single pair Ethernet as a technology to the market. So what we do together is to develop a so-called ecosystem. This consists of the technology itself, the standards around, and the components. And this brings us directly to the topic of today. One of the very important components are the magnetics, so the transformers and filters circuits, as one of the key components in between the semiconductors at one side, and at the other side, the cabling with the connectivity and so on. And the magnetics are, for some persons, for me also some years ago, a big question mark. There are several things behind interesting to know. And this is the point I want to hand over to Martin, who will give you all the news about, the magnetics here at first for 110 megabit, and also the powering issue with this so-called Poodle power over data line standard. So very welcome, Martin, and it's your turn now to give us all the details. Thanks so far.
Thank you, Matthias. Hello to everyone. So today we want to talk about magnetics for single pair Ethernet. My name is Martin Leinseder and I'm working for the Wirth Electronic ISOS group. I'm a product manager, and in our department we mostly take care about filtering, about power inductors, and everything what you can find on a circuit board for magnetics. And like Matthias said at the beginning, the filters for single pair Ethernet, the filters, they are a very small part of the single pair Ethernet network. Yeah, we have cables, we have connectors, we have chips and everything, and the magnetics, they are a very small part of the circuit board, but they are a very important part of the circuit board. Without the magnetics, you will have EMI issues on your board. ESD can destroy components, or in case of transformers, a galvanic isolation is not existing. Yeah, which you need for certain norms. Yeah, and so I want to start with you with this agenda here. If you see this agenda and you have already seen some webinars from my side, then this looks quite familiar to you, because the chapters are basically the same, but the content, especially for the power over data line, is very different. Yeah. So I first want to give you some introduction, a short one about signal filtering, followed by single pair Ethernet solutions, different solutions for 10 base T1, for 100 base T1, and then, and this is in big letters, the power over data line. Here we did several things in the last year, some new things, and especially the new things. This is what I like to introduce to you. And if you are a design engineer and you want to design simple Ethernet and especially power over data line, this might be interesting for you. So signal filtering, we can find signal filtering, yeah, almost everywhere where we have connectors and bus systems. In this picture, you can see how the solution of the filtering is looking like at a Profibus. On the left-hand side, this is a small demo board that we have with a connector on the right side, a connector on the left side, and in the middle there is the filtering. The big part here, this is a common mode choke. This is needed to decrease or to filter common mode signals. This is quite a big part here in this circuit because we have low frequencies and therefore we need a higher inductance in deeper frequencies. You also can see here are TVS diodes, so we have a ESD protection inside, and on the power line there is a P filter. So this is more or less the filtering that we need for Profibus. Yeah? If you're interested in that, we have an application note. You can follow this link here, and there you find more information, measurement, and so on some pages. The same thing that we can find for Profibus, of course, we can also find for Ethernet, so for the standard Ethernet. Yeah, as you can see on the picture, this is also a board that we designed with a PHY chip. On the left side, this is the MDI. Here is the RJ45 connector. You can buy these RJ45 connectors with filters inside or without. In this case, this is without a filter inside. And the filtering here is discrete. This is a transformer and common mode chokes. Here we have a gigabit network, so we have four transformers and four common mode chokes. Also, we have some termination resistors, capacitors, and TVS diodes. This is the so-called, this together with the connector, this is so-called the MDI. And when we look at single pair Ethernet, this is a further board that we designed, then we can see the same elements here. Yeah? We can see the MDI again. We can see the PHY chip again. We have something, this is RxTx mixing. This is that there is no signal collision, there we have some resistors. In difference to the board with the Ethernet that I showed you before, here we also added a microcontroller to calculate with the signals that comes from the PHY chip. And here this is a power supply for the PHY chip or for the microcontroller. Yeah, that's it. So this circuit board that you can see, this has maybe the size of a check card, so it's quite small, and you can make this even smaller. So if you put together the components more closely or on both sides of the board, you can save a lot of space here. So, but first the question, what is the signal per Ethernet filtering at all? So we have seen the LAN transformer filtering with the four transformers and four common mode chokes in case of gigabit Ethernet, but what about single pair Ethernet? And like I showed in the last session, you can see here also what was coming out from the automotive market. Single pair Ethernet basically came up at the automotive market to have only two cables instead of more wires. Yeah, you can save a lot of space with that, and you can build your application with only two wires and small space on circuit board, and the filtering is looking like that. Now we have a common mode choke. This common mode choke needs to be very broadband for the single pair Ethernet signal. We have a common mode termination. Yeah, we have a common mode termination also for common mode signals, and also it has some kind of a ESD function. And then we have two capacitors as galvanic isolation inside. And these two capacitors, this is the thing why we're discussing here, because this is okay for automotive Ethernet as galvanic isolation, but these capacitors only have an isolation of 50 volt DC, and 50 volt DC is not enough when we look at the norm of the IEEE, especially for 10 base T1. Then we see the the safety requirements are referred to the IEC 62368-1, yeah, or the old 60950-1. And this says we need to have 1.5 kilovolt or 1500 volt AC of isolation. And this isolation needs to hold for 1 minute. In the automotive, this is fine to have 50 volt of isolation because you have a system where the user cannot touch inside. So you won't open the chassis of your car and add a camera or something to your system. But in the industry, it's a different case, and therefore we need this isolation. And so we made our thoughts what we can do to guarantee this isolation, but also that the signals are inside the norm requirements of the IEEE. And so we have here the norm specification from the IEEE for the MDI. Yeah? Here we have the return loss in blue and the mode conversion loss in green. And our values should be under this line that we have here. The mode conversion loss limit is at minus 25 dB. But from experts, from discussion with experts, also from other companies, it figured out that a real or better value to set your limit is more or less at minus 45 dB. Yeah, so this should be our limit also for the next discussion. Although with the norm, minus 25 dB is okay. The challenge here is the frequency between 100 kilohertz and 1 megahertz. This is very, very, very less. And therefore, we need to have certain thinking about how we can do this. And what we did is that we built it up three circuit boards here. One circuit board with 10 base T1 is the automotive Ethernet design that we have here. Yeah, you can see there are very small capacitors, and these are the 50 volt capacitors, but we have a very big common mode choke inside. The example before was for 100 base T1. Yeah, now we have 10 base T1, we have lower frequencies, and for the lower frequencies to guarantee a good signaling at lower frequencies, we need a high inductance. And therefore the common mode choke needs to be very large. In the middle, we have built up the same circuit, but we said, okay, let's try it with capacitors that can hold the 1.5 kilovolt of isolation. So the next larger size is a 2 kV capacitor. And so we have two of them. These are quite expensive parts. So we don't have them in our company. We don't supply this. But over distributors, we could get some parts that we could try out. And on the right-hand side, we used a circuit with a LAN transformer. Why we use the circuit with a LAN transformer? Yeah, well, we said, okay, the single pair Ethernet signals and the ones of the standard Ethernet, they are quite similar. So let's try it with a LAN transformer also. Yeah, and so we did this out of our standard program, so more or less to say. And this is the results that we gained from our measurements. Yeah, you can see here we have the return loss again. This is the black curve here. And then we see the curves from the capacitor solutions in gray and black, and from the transformer solution in red. And what we can see, especially what I said in the deep frequencies, that we have some issues at the deep frequencies, or that the lines are very close to the limit. And when we go closer to this, there you can also see the scale here, so between 100 kilohertz and 1 megahertz. So I zoom inside, also you can see 100 kilohertz to 1 megahertz. There we see that, yeah, it's very close, the capacitor solution is very close to the limit, while the transformer solution has a better performance in deep frequencies. The same here now with the mode conversion loss. Again, we said, okay, we more or less put the limit to minus 45 dB. And what we can see as a result, we have very good values for all of the solution with some advantage for the capacitor solution, which is changing at around, what is this, 5 megahertz maybe. Then the transformer solution is better, but we can say all in all solutions are sufficient to fit to the IEEE for 10 base T1. Some details maybe to the circuit of the transformer here. How what is this from what is this consisting, this circuit, yeah? So first of all, we have our TVS diode. This is now on the PHY chip side and not on the connector side. People will say, why you do this on the PHY chip side and not on the connector side? Normally, so for ESD, it's better to put the TVS diode really on the connector side because you want to get the ESD as soon as possible after it's coming inside from the connector or from the cable. But in this case, we put it on the PHY chip side because if customers are doing their hypo testing and they do the hypo testing from connector side to PHY chip side, everything is fine. But if they do the hypo testing from connector side to the ground, then all the voltage will be leaded over the TVS diode, and so the TVS diode can be destroyed. So if you do hypo testing later in your application and you want to test from the pins from the signaling to the ground, then you should remove your TVS diode or put it to the other side, then it's working. Yeah. Then of course we have the transformer. The transformer T1, this is because of the galvanic isolation, yeah. Frequencies in signals in high frequencies, high frequency ranges will be lead through the transformer, while a constant current will be blocked. And this is how a transformer is working. Also, a transformer has some function. It can lead common mode signals to the ground. And this is also helping because we also want to decrease common mode signals, and with the common mode signal, the mode conversion. Yeah. Then we have R1 and C1. This is a termination resistor and capacitor. This capacitor is a 2 kV capacitor because of the tests of the high voltage with the 1.5 kV. Then we have the capacitor C2. Capacitor C2 is some kind of a blocking capacitor because the PHY chip, you know, normally a signal for LAN or for single pair Ethernet is plus minus 1 volt or plus minus 2 volt. But a PHY chip cannot send negative signals. It can only send positive signals. And so what a PHY chip is doing, it's sending some offsets on the signals. And so your voltage is maybe plus 1 volt and plus 3 volt. Yeah. And so that there is no current going to ground. We need this capacitor. And so this voltage is blocked. And then very interesting, we have this capacitor C3. And this is something that is not normally what you can see on Ethernet. We put this between the middle pins, and especially for 10 base T1, it has the function that this increases or that it improves the performance in low frequencies. If you cannot put the capacitor C3 on the middle pin, there is another option. You can take the same capacitor value and put it on the outside of the transformer, and then you have more or less the same function, yeah, and also the same performance. After we were finished with this circuit, this was last year in spring. We were very happy about that the performance was so good. But then we went into discussion with IC houses, and the IC houses, they had some concern, and the concern was about the droop measurement. And the question is, what is a droop measurement? Yeah, in the IEEE there is a chapter. It's not related to the MDI, but it's related to the PHY chip, and it says if you put the PHY chip on a certain test mode 2, then and you measure the signal on the connector, then the drop of the signal shouldn't be more than 10%. Yeah, and it took us a while because we needed to take a PHY chip and to program the PHY chip until we really could do the measurement and had a look what the requirements really were. And what we could find out is that if we measure the droop, that with our old schematic, we had a droop which was 10.2%. So it was too much. Yeah. And so what we did is that we looked at our circuit again and checked what we can do to improve the performance. And what we did is, it was simple. The solution, we increased the value of our capacitor. Before it was 200 nanofarad, but now we increase it to 470 nanofarad. Also, we can increase the inductance of the transformer from 350 microhenry to 600 microhenry. You can choose one of these two options or both of the options, and then you can decrease the droop to, let's say, 6 or 8%. Yeah. And on the right side, you can see how the circuit looks like. In this case, here you see the capacitors that are now outside and not in between the middle pins. But like I said, you can also take one of these capacitors and put it on the transformer middle pin. For 100 base T1, I only go roughly through this, yeah, as I like to talk about power over data line a bit more. We also did the same tests. Yeah, you can see this is the advantage of automotive Ethernet. Yeah, everything is very compact, everything is very small, and the components are not expensive. Yeah, there we did this experiment with a smaller Kammer choke. The same thing with the 2 kV capacitors, again, also where the Kammer choke gets small, and then with the transformer again. Here, in difference, we have no capacitor C3 anymore. This is not needed because the frequencies are not so deep anymore. But therefore, we need a common mode choke for the higher frequencies to cover this. And the results for return loss were also sufficient, with advantages for the capacitor solution in frequencies up to 20 megahertz. After 20 megahertz, the transformer solution is in between the 50 volt capacitors and the 2 kV capacitors. And with the mode conversion loss, we see again there is some issue in higher frequencies. And if we zoom more closely, then we can see, aha, the 50 volt capacitor solution, it comes very closely to the limit of the IEEE here for the mode conversion loss. Here, I can say you can improve this, of course, if you take a larger common mode choke. Yeah. So for our tests, we always took the same common mode choke. If you take the larger common mode choke, the signal will be improved, of course. But this is the same for the transformer. Also, here we can improve the signal with a larger common mode choke. Yeah. By the way, people asked us about 10. So before I was talking about 10 base T1L. So the longer reach up to 1 kilometer. Yeah, but people are asking, what about 10 base T1S? Yeah, how we cover the requirements here? And here I have a slide where I integrated also the limits of the IEEE for return loss and mode conversion loss. And we can see that the limits are very close to what are the limits for 100 base T1. And this means if you want to implement 10 base T1S, then you can take the same circuit like for 100 base T1 for 10 base T1S. Yeah, so this is working. Good. And here you can see a picture how this is looking like on the circuit board. Again, with the 50 volt capacitor solution, 100 base T1 very, very small, but also the transformer solution very, very small, while the 2 kV capacitor solution is quite large because of the capacitors. So, and now I'm coming to the topic power over data line and want to show you what we have figured out in the last months about that. Yeah. So first of all, when we talk about power over data line, then I want to say some short words about power over Ethernet. And yeah, for power over Ethernet, in this case, we have a 100 base T1, 100 base T system, sorry, where we have, for 100 base T, we have two channels, a transmission channel and a receive channel. And the signals, they go from fire chip to the cable. Yeah, because there are signals where the current is changing very fastly. But as the voltage or the current for power over Ethernet is a constant current, it will be blocked on the transformer and leaded to a DC-DC converter and a transformer, and then it can supply, for example, a camera. But what we are doing now, if you only have one channel, like we have for single-pair Ethernet. And here you can see how the circuit is looking like, four single pair Ethernet without power over data line. If we want to add power over data line, then we can do this by adding two lines. Yeah, so this is, in this case, yeah, this could be the power source, where the power source is on a circuit board, and the current is not going to the transformer because of these capacitors, C3 and C4, because these capacitors, they blocking the current. Yeah, so the current is not going to the transformer. This has a good function because if the current is not going to the transformer cannot go into saturation by the current, and so we always can use the same size of transformer. Yeah, always use a small signal transformer, not need to have a bigger one. Yeah? And yeah, so if we implement these capacitors, then the current will go over the cable in this case, or it will come from the cable and go to the circuit board. Yeah, so the transformer is not touched anymore. Regarding the capacitor C3 and C4, there is also something to say, and this is about the voltage. Yeah, if we have a system with power over data line, then the maximum voltage could be 60 volt, and therefore we need to take care on the values, on the voltage values of the capacitors. Here we cannot use 50 volt capacitors anymore, because when we see the capacitance drop, if we apply the full voltage, then it would be, yeah, the capacitance, that it will go down with the as higher the voltage is. In our case, we used now a 100 volt capacitor, and this means that if you, for example, have a 48 volt system for power over data line, that on every capacitor there is 24 volt, and this means the capacitance is dropping on about 16%. Yeah, and if you would use a 50 volt capacitor for C3 and C4, then the capacitance will be dropping on maybe 60%. Yeah, which would be too much then. This is again the circuit that we had, and if we want to add and if we want to have power over data line, of course we need the filter choke L2. The filter choke L2 has a function. It should block the signals that are coming over the signal line RX plus and RX minus. If the filter choke is not inside and you apply power over data line, then the signals of RX plus will be go through this power path and would come back to RX minus, and so your signal will be totally destroyed. And so we need to block these signals. And because of 10BASE-T1, because the signals are very, very low frequency signals, we need to have a very high inductance for the filter choke here also. Yeah, and this makes the filter choke, of course, large, and of course also depending of the current. Yeah, if you have 1 ampere of current, then the wire needs to be very thick. Yeah. We later will see a picture about how this can look like. Yeah. We did measurements on our solution that we had so far, and the performance was quite promising. Yeah. On the left hand side we see the return loss, and the return loss, everything is quite good. Looks very nice. On the right hand side we see normally, you know, from the IEEE you measure on the PHY chip. And here we measured also on the PHY chip. This is the red line, and here also everything is okay. Yeah. But if you measure on the cable or on the connector, or if we measure between cable and connector, we see that we here hit our 45 dB limit. Yeah. So again, we say our limit is 45 dB. Of course, if you want to use this part, or if you want to use this filters in between the IEEE limits, then you need to look at the minus 25 limit, and then everything is nice. Yeah. And also, because normally we measure on the PHY chip side, everything is good, even for the 45 dB limit. But if we say, okay, what about a cable and what about a minus 45 dB limit, we should also have a look at those frequencies here, or at the mode conversion loss here. Yeah. That, like I said, it does not fit the minus 45 dB limit if we set this. Yeah. So what we did is that we made some improvements on the design, And this is what I like to show you here. So first of all, we implemented a common mode choke here, an additional one. And this additional common mode choke, yeah, it should decrease the common mode signals that are coming from the cable or that are coming from the file chip. Yeah, and if the common mode is decreased, also the mode conversion is decreased, because the mode conversion is a common mode signal that is changing into a normal signal, so to say. Yeah. As lesser the common mode signal, as lesser things can change. Yeah. So we need a common mode choke here, L1. And then we have, but then we figured out later on that we have a problem here, because we figured out that there is a patent on this circuit. So if you have power over data line, so I'm not talking about the single pair Ethernet without power over data line, I'm talking with single pair Ethernet with power over data line. Yeah. And you have this combination of a transformer and these two capacitors here and this choke, this filter choke, then this is a patent from Broadcom, based on made in 2011. Yeah, and this of course is a problem, because this is a very basic a patent here. And so what we did is that we went back to our solution that I introduced to before, and that we put that we replaced the C3 and C4 capacitor again to a capacitor in between the middle pin. Yeah, and with this solution here, we have an alternative which is not patented. So you can really use this, and you not need to get a license from everyone. So this is really free for everyone. And yeah, we also did not make a patent for the solution with the C3 capacitor. So you are free to use it as you like. But what about the performance here? And so we compared the performance with the, so to say, patented solution and the alternative solution. And yeah, what we can see here, and by the way, these are simulations here. So so far we did not make the real measurements, but I can tell you that our simulations are very, very accurate, because they are based on measurements of the real components, yeah, that we bring together in the simulation then later. And what we can see here is that simulation of the patented version and the alternative is very, very similar, only there are small differences in low frequencies. And also for the mode conversion, the result looks very, very promising. So with the patented solution, we are in between all limits, if we say the IEEE limit or the improved IEEE limit, so to say, if we measure on the file chip, if we measure on the connector, if we measure between connector and file chip, everything is working in the allowed parameters. Yeah, this is very, very good, I think, from the results. And also from the troop measurement, we did a troop measurement. And also here, we had 8% of throop, which is, of course, under the 10%, which is also good news. Here you can see how the circuit is looking like if we put it on a board. With the connector here, in this case, this is a Harting connector. There we have a common mode choke again. And here, this is the transformer. By the way, for the transformer, we used for power over data line, we used a 600 microhenry transformer. For the measurements we did with the signals only, we used a 350 microhenry transformer. So the transformer is a bit larger than what we need for the signals. And what we have here, this is the filter choke that we implemented. In this case, this is a filter choke that can handle, I think, 1 ampere of current, yeah, and where the inductance is very high. So this is a quite big part here. Yeah, but what means big? Yeah, so if we compare this, if you have seen such a connector by your own eyes, then you also see this is a very small part. So it's not so big, this filter choke. And here we have the components. Also, in this circuit, we have the capacitor C3 and C4. And here is the alternative. So if you want to work with the patented version, so to say, you remove the C3 capacitor and you have the capacitor C3 and C4 then here, or you remove those and you only have the capacitor C3 on the other side. So both is working. Here is the circuit on another perspective. By the way, you see here some capacitors here and you see a bit on the other side. This was our first try that we did, and we implemented capacitors, but we figured out that we don't need them. Yeah, so in real life, this capacitor and this will be removed. Yeah, and here we can see the filter chokes that we used for our simulations. And with the filter chokes that we have in our product program, we could cover the first 8 cover power classes for power over data line according to the IEEE 802.3BU. Yeah, and for the smaller currents up to I think 400 milliamp, so this is the class 1 and 2, 3 4, 0, 1, 2, 4, and 6, there we can use the small filter choke with 7.3 millimeters in length and width, and for the higher power classes, therefore we need a larger filter choke with a length and a width. Sorry, I cannot see it because there's a window before. I think it's 12.5 millimeters that we had. Yeah. Also for there are other power classes, yeah, power classes 10 to 14. Also, therefore, we can use most of our filter chokes only for the highest power classes there, yeah, with about 1.6 amp. We have no small filter choke in our product program, but we are also working on that. So, and here you can see how this circuit is build up with power over data lines, a complete circuit board, again with a filter choke here for 1 ampere. These capacitors you don't need, but this is how a circuit with power over data line can look like. If you need more information about single pair Ethernet and filtering, you can go on our website, and there you find more information. You find webinars and also, yeah, some small movie. This site will be updated frequently, so just have a look. Also, you find, like I said, the webinar. Some single pair Ethernet application note. If you follow this link, also www.ee-online.com/ANP085, there you find the application node. Also, you can find the application node on our single pair Ethernet partner network page. And this is a very, very useful site. So if you follow this link, you find many more articles and white papers and application notes. So it gives you a whole bunch of very interesting and important information about single pair Ethernet. And of course, also this page will be updated frequently, so just have a look. And if you have questions, you can ask me, you can ask also other partners of the single pair Ethernet partner network, you can ask Matthias Fritsche. So just have a look and contact us if you have questions. So that's it from my presentation. Thank you for listening, and if you have questions, then I'm here for answering all what you got. Thank you.
Yeah. Hello, Martin. Thanks so much for all this very deep technical informations. I see also a lot of persons in our call today, and we received some first questions also. Let's look a little bit around. I have one. It's very interesting also, I guess, also for others. Thanks also for the information about Poodle. Here the information come in. If I use Poodle, for example, also for the 1000 meter 10 megabit use case, is the use of Poodle reducing the range I can achieve? Do you have some information for this?
Yeah. Yeah, so I would say yes and no. So for the signals, this the power over data line has no effect. Yeah, so I can transfer signals over 1,000 meters. But the question, of course, is about the power that I transfer. Yeah, as longer the cable, of course, as more losses you got. And therefore, as higher the current is, as shorter you should make the cable. You need to see that if you double the current, then the losses are four times higher always. Yeah, and so if you have an application, you should really look for the current. But you can do this, you can calculate the losses by yourself. When you open the data sheet of the cable, then you see how much resistance a cable has over, let's say, 1,000 meters. And then you can calculate with the current that you have and the resistance, what are your losses over the cable.
Yeah, exactly. So the physics, especially with the voltage drop, is always the limit.
Yeah.
And for this, so with my experience from cable and connector side, it's depending, of course, on the copper cross section. What we see, if you go with the typical field bus cable, what the group around the process industry for advanced physical layer APL is proposing, is you need cables with American wire gauge 16, 18 to reach nearly the 1,000 meter. For shorter ranges, depending on the power, again, you can also use thinner wires here. The connectivity we support in our network definitely have no problem at all for this. It's really mainly a cable issue. Yeah. Here's another question come up related to the evaluation board you show, the active board at one of the last pages. One of our members today in the webinar wants to know which kind of Ethernet file you use for your measurements. So what are the active devices you to use to evaluate your solution?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so in this case of this circuit board, this was a file chip from Analog Devices. And this, the name is 181100. This is a 10 base T1L file chip. But of course, we are also trying other file chips from other IC companies. But yeah, in this example, it was from Analog Devices.
Yeah, these are the products also Analog is launching. And here, question come up directly. Did you have some other vendors for 10 base T1L? Yes, there is also something open visible in the market from Texas Instruments here. So these are the two vendors at the moment for 10 megabit long range. And nevertheless, all the very welcome or very well known names in this market, like Broadcom, Marvel, Microchip, On Semiconductor, NXP, and so offers also files for different speeds and different applications for single pair Ethernet. So if you have a project, also we can support here in this point. We as network collect all the information we can get from the market as a kind of internal database. If you have a project and wants to know something more for it, you can also get this information from us if you use our website and go in contact with us. Some other points coming up. I guess we touched this point already. Is the type of transformer depending on the power over data line power rating? Yes, it is, and yeah. I guess you can add something here also from your side.
It's like that. With the capacitors, the current for power over data line is not coming to the transformer. Normally, for power over Ethernet, if we have a higher current rating, also the transformer gets larger because the current goes over the transformer, and that it's not going into saturation. We need a core material which is less sensible for the current, and therefore normally for the standard Ethernet, we take we need more material. We have a material which has less of permeability, yeah? But to reach the normally 350 microhenry of inductance of a transformer, we need more of this core material. And of course, because of the wires are thicker, we need also have the larger cores. In case of single pair Ethernet, the current does not come over the transformer, and so we can take the same transformers than we can take for the signals. But what we did, and this is what Matthias also mentioned, we took another transformer. We took for the signals, we took a 350 microhenry transformer. For power over data line, we took a transformer with 600 microhenry. This is because we want to improve the droop. And therefore we said, okay, we need a bit more inductance in the deeper frequencies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I can add a little bit in general to Pudel. Martin, can you go to the page where you have all the different power classes? Yeah, this one.
Here?
Yeah. Some information also for our people in the seminar today. So in the first table, the classes 0 to 9 coming up from the IEEE 802.3 BQ standard. This was a basic standard for Pudel, and it's very strongly focused also to automotive applications. You see it here if you look to the voltage level. It's also a big difference between Pudel and PoE. For PoE, we have just one voltage level, the 48 to 60 volts, but here with the focus on car applications, they add the typical board net voltages, so 12 volt, 24 volt, and 48 volt. And what we see at the moment also in the market for the semiconductors and controllers, there are products on the roadmaps from the different vendors for this classes 1 to 9 focused on automotive applications. And with the CC standard, so for the 10 megabit, they add I will say industrial power classes 10 to 15. And especially the 24 volt classes for 10, 11, and 12 are strongly recommended to use for industrial use cases. And to give some insights from discussions I had in the last year with customers, this might be the most useful classes for industry. So we have the 24 voltage. We use for automation control everywhere. And also here we can cover from nearly a little bit more than 1 watt to nearly 10 watts. Everything was is related to sensors and also mostly for the most of the controllers. So if you look to frequency transformers or something else, it'd be also enough to power over Pudel all the control circuit you have in a frequency transformer or on. And the additional power, for example, in a frequency transformer comes really from the network line. So that will be interesting. So if you think about automotive applications, the classes 1 to 9 are, I guess, the right one. You have to take in consideration if you look to industrial automation, 10 to 12 are okay. And the other classes with the higher voltage are definitely also for the longer reach 1,000 meters. So this is interesting to know also for you. And at the moment, ongoing discussions are in different user groups. For example, there's a group working on IO-Link Plus and also in Profinet and other use cases, there are discussions ongoing. And I have the feeling that classes 10 to 12 will be the favorite classes for industrial automation. I guess most of the questions are done. If you have some other very special question later on, feel free also to go in contact with us. Thanks so far for your attention. I hope it was informative for you. You get some detailed information you might be used for your design you have in front of you or you're thinking about. At the end of our today's session of the Single Pair Ethernet Pioneer Summit, I want to give you the information. This is an ongoing webinar session. We will have more webinars during the year. You get, of course, also a newsletter about it, and you found more sessions in our LinkedIn channel and also on our webpage. And it will be continuing to update it every month or every regular weeks. In addition, I want to say thanks for your attention today, and hopefully we see us in one of the next sessions again. and have a good time. And also summer is coming, holiday season is in front of us. So everyone who has holiday time in the next time, we wish you also a very nice holiday time, relax, and hopefully we see us back for one of the next sessions for the future. Yeah.
So many things also from my side, and have a good day.
Bye bye for today.